And so how this works is that when you touch fan leaves, you actually suck the water out of the leaves and store it inside the stem. That causes a change in water pressure, which forces the leaves to close up on each other. Mm. You folks are more than welcome to kind of squeeze in and, you know, touch fan leaves.
What benefit of that?
It's a defense mechanism. So if a predator tries to eat it, you know, they'll fold up those leaves, they'll kind of get freaked out. It's very safe for them. If like, there's too much wind or rain, it protects the leaves because now there's less surface area. They're not kind of like, well, out like this. Now their leaves are safe from the elements as well.
How come the plants don't just sink in?
So what we've done here, great question, what we've done here is that we've taken a piece of normal styrofoam, cut little squares into it, and then we've stuffed like little rock wool cubes in those holes, and then we'll plant the seeds in the rock wool. And those roots will grow through the rock wool and reach the water.
So
who's ready for some free food? All right, you know, it's the only free food you'll get here at Disney, so I absolutely recommend that you try to take it. Absolutely. So we talked about hydroponics. How many of you folks are interested in trying this in your own home? Awesome. So I do have a handout that I can pass out to you guys, and we'll actually teach you how to create your own hydroponic garden in a fish tank, just like you see there. So welcome to our production greenhouse, everybody. We're going to kind of walk and talk. But the reason this is our screen greenhouse, like I said, also not a production greenhouse, just because all the plants that you see here are absolutely 100% used as food at the different restaurants around Disney. And here we're coming up against our cucumber plant. In fact, the same cucumbers that you guys tried no more than a minute ago in our cucumber taste test. So actually, during around about this time, we'll put our cucumbers in these special molds. And that way, during the holiday season, they will take the shape of that mold and we'll get Mickey Mouse shaped cucumbers.
Oh, that's awesome. Wow. Oh, that's cute.
And if you folks missed any pictures as we're walking, do not fret. We are going to come the exact same way out as we're going in, so you'll have a second chance to catch those pictures that you missed. Every time you hear that popping noise, it is nutrients being added to the water. So everything that these plants need are in this water. And so the water will run all the way to the end of the trough, through the gutter, where it's collected in the trough, and sent right back into the gutter. So this, all the water here is constantly being used, none of it is wasted. Now these lettuce plants are actually a wintertime vegetable, so when it's hot like it is now during the summer, these things will actually flower, making them inedible. So we've chilled the water that you just saw so that the plant is tricked into thinking it's winter time. Tippy top part, either the leaves or the tippy top of the plant is the most tender and juiciest part of the plant, sort of like the filet mignon for the insect. And so these sachets are filled with a predator mite that will eat the pest mites that damage our plants. Now we don't only use the weak matter wasps and the predator mites, we use a variety of different biological controls. One such control agent is ladybugs. And being the good entomologist that I am, I always keep several vials of ladybugs in my pocket just in case for such a moment. So could I have a couple of volunteers come up and release some ladybugs on our plants? Any volunteers? No?
Oh, I'll do it.
Okay. All right, there you go. One more? Oh, okay, all right. So I'm going to step behind the arm is not to happen. Plants, you guys can just take a plant that you like and open up your vials and release those ladybugs.
It gets a lot.
As long as you don't pass this point, you guys are more than welcome to just take a plant and open them. So when you pop those vial lids open, and you flip the vial upside down and give the vial a nice firm tap, these ladybugs are stubborn and they will not come out on their own. You'll have a force field.
Ay, se cayó una al piso.
Maybe don't be afraid to hurt them. They're pretty robust insects. You can just kind of give them a nice little whack, you know. Oh, that's okay. They will be fine, and they'll fly right back up. Yeah, they're actually really gracious.
Que eso es parte del polinizar las plantas.
And I'll collect those files back from y'all. Thank you very much.
Bueno, ay, la papisa.
And they're very popular, especially in a lot of Asian countries, in soups and stews. And that's because although they're rather bland by themselves, they soak up a lot of flavor. So when they're put in those soups and stews, they can soak up all of that broth. And you see in our winter melons, this leaf has been damaged by the leaf miner fly. So we have released parasitoid wasps, and so these leaves may have been damaged, but all the leaves up here are totally safe. I'm sorry? Yeah, they slipped through the cracks. So you'll notice we have these rows in the sand, and that's because wherever there's a row, you'll see that's where these pipes and tubes that we call drip irrigation have been laid down. And so all drip irrigation is, like I said, is just a series of pipes and tubes that have been placed underneath the sand, but on top of the plant roots. And so the water, just like the name suggests, is slowly drip right on top of those plant roots, and that way we don't have to worry about the water being lost to evaporation or to the water table. So it's a very efficient way to save water because you don't have to water as often because everything is going straight to the plant. Now behind me, I have a fruit that although it looks like, to me, at least it looks like salami, it's actually a fruit known as cassa banana. So cassa banana is native to Brazil where it's mostly grown. So you guys probably won't find these guys in your local grocery store too often. And it is a melon. It's related to cucumbers. Okay, this one, it actually has a very lovely fragrance. So you folks are more than welcome to pass it around. And it smells like apples. And so these guys are not eaten too often. They're mostly used for that fragrance because these guys can last apple. Several months mm-hmm. off the vine.
It's like apple.
And so as the longer that they stay off the vine, the more that their fragrance intensifies, and so they'll just use it as a natural air freshener. Now I really want to point out my favorite tree in all of temperate. It is the tree, kind of funky looking tree across the waterway. It's green and spiny looking. It almost looks like the Charlie Brown Christmas tree. Very good, that is absolutely right. It is the monkey puzzle tree. Best name for a tree I've ever heard. And this is actually the national tree of Chile. And just like the redwoods, these guys can get up to 100 feet tall. And they actually do harvest these guys as a food source. They will harvest the seeds and eat the seeds, sort of like we eat walnuts or pecans or that kind of thing. Alrighty folks, so we're gonna keep moving through temperate. Long time to produce fruit. In fact, it takes them 5 years to produce one batch of fruit. So it's a very long, intensive process. And most of the world olives are produced in either Italy or Greece. And that's why these guys are native to Mediterranean climates. That's where I see it. It's like the other way around. These guys are native to Mediterranean climates, which is why Italy and Greece are the largest producers of olives in the
world. That's why it's so expensive.
Mm-hmm.
it's not on the aqua road, but it's not on the aqua climate.
Un limón de 9 libras. Está brutal. Sí.
Fermented, ground, and then like fruits again or something like that. It's very long process, and so that's why it does take a very long time to make chocolate. And what's really cool about cacao is that the fruit, a lot of trees that you see are macadamia and are star fruit, all the fruits are located around the bushy part of the canopy where the leaves are. Well, cacao can actually produce those fruits anywhere along the bark. And so all this frilly stuff are actually the flowers of cacao. You can see how tiny they are. They're actually pretty, especially nice looking flowers. Very pretty. And the last tree I want to talk to you folks about on this kind of lineup is tamarind. So a fun fact about tamarind is actually, it is the secret ingredient in Worcestershire sauce. So if you guys have ever poked a Worcestershire sauce that has kind of a sweetness to it, it comes from tamarind. Alrighty folks, quick question for you. Which is the star fruit? This guy or this guy? This is a trick question. Believe it or not, this is the star fruit. This actually was referred to as a fluted pumpkin. And a great way to tell the difference is that just like the shape of a star, the star fruit has 5 points to it. Fluted pumpkin actually has 10, so twice the amount of points that a normal star would have. Now, fluted pumpkins are native to Africa, where they're actually a staple food crop, and they're actually used for their seeds. So this is a picture of what the fruit looks like on the inside. The yellow squashy-like kind of substance that you see on the inside is not actually what's eaten, it's actually the seeds. And they'll roast the seeds and they'll eat them kind of like we, you know, eat chestnuts or that kind of thing. But the reason these guys are a staple food crop is because they're extremely drought-resistant and they can handle all the nutrients of the soil, so they're a very stable source of food for the people who grow them. Alrighty folks, it is time to test your culinary knowledge and the spice challenge. So prepare your notes, everybody. I'm going to pass on a couple of different spices.
Gracias.
You guys are more than welcome to take a whiff. Please do not taste them, because if you plan on eating lunch afterwards, you'll blow your taste buds off and you'll taste nothing but spice.
Acá lo bueno. Ya, che. What is that? What is it? Rosemary?
That's actually a clue to what it is. But we'll talk about it, I promise. Alrighty folks, this is super duper easy. What was this spice?
Pepper.
Very good. This is black pepper. All of these peppercorns came from Mickey Mouse black pepper tree. It's a great photo op, so I absolutely recommend taking a picture with Mickey. Now all these different colored peppercorns actually came from the same peppercorn tree. A lot of people think since they're different colors, they're all different varieties of peppercorn. So how it actually works is that all the peppercorns will start green. As they ripen, they'll change color. So they'll turn green to red, from red to black, and then black to white, which is where we get our black and white pepper.
Oh, single. Oh, yeah.
Alrighty, what about this one? Very good, this is lavender. So here in the United States, we do not typically eat lavender. Every once in a while, you'll see them have like a novelty item like lavender honey or maybe lavender tea. Thank you very much. However, France is the world's largest consumer of lavender. So here's our lavender plant right here. They will actually harvest these purple flowers and then they'll sprinkle that as a topping on their salads. Alrighty folks, here is the trick question. What do you think this one was?
Allspice.
Close.
Allspice.
Very good, this is allspice. Give yourselves a pat on the back, everybody. The reason I said that this is a trick question, because allspice is named because it smells and tastes like cinnamon, clove, nutmeg, all at the same time, hence allspice. So how many of you folks have used pumpkin pie spice or like pumpkin pie? Awesome, so we are coming up to that time of season, pumpkin pie season. And so allspice is the spice that you use in pumpkin pie. Which is why it's a great food, because at Thanksgiving time you use a lot of allspice for your pumpkin pies. Alrighty folks, I want to thank you so very much for joining me today. today on the Behind the Scenes tour. I hope you folks enjoyed it as much as I enjoyed giving it to you. So what's going to happen is that you guys have a moment to take a few extra pictures. If you have any more questions.
You are warmly invited to join Mickey Mouse and his Fantasyland friends for a magical celebration in the streets. Dreams will come true, hearts will soar, and you will become a part of the